This is a follow-up to a presentation about POSIX that I gave 4 years ago in Magdeburg. I'm only using a few slides just to so that people who didn't see the presentation can catch up and get a flavor of what POSIX is, and then I will talk mostly about things that I've added in the recent past and a little bit of work in progress that is going on right now. You may have noticed that I was still typing in some numbers. This is because data is arriving and I'm still checking things and making sure that what I'm going to present now is not going to be wrong. It's always easy to make mistakes. So this is a slide that you may have seen in my presentation 4 years ago. It's about early days when POSIX was still being written. I had started work in January 1997. And by May, I had something that could sort of work. It ran on my workstation, and I was receiving mail from the network, and it was storing it in my mailbox, and it did a few other things. And I started doing some performance measurements. The previous speaker is like me. You build a system, then you test it, and you test it really thoroughly, because it's better for you to find the mistakes than someone else and embarrass you. And as I was doing the performance tests, I noticed that mail systems are really, really slow. And this was because, of course, disks are a lot slower than CPUs, and that doesn't really change over time. CPUs are still faster than disk drives, and there was an interesting discussion about mail systems and performance. And this was one of the quotes that was cited. There's a lot more of these. So besides doing POSIX, I also have been doing things with computer security. So you will have to bear with me for a few minutes as I rant about computer security, why it's hard, and things like that. So I have a few slides on buggy software works. Then I have I make a transition into POSIX by discussing strategies to make systems more secure. I will discuss POSIX a little bit from the biased point of view that the more work you can delegate to other people, the better. And extensibility is one way of making system possible, able of, delegating work to other people. I have a light section on market share, some really, recent developments, work in progress, and a little bit of crystal ball. But this is the security segment. One of the problems with security is that there are lots of problems with security. But one of the problems is that software doesn't really do what you expect it to do. So my definition of secure software is a secure system does what you expect the system to do. If the system does more, then it's not good. If the system does less, then it's probably also not good. So the system does exactly what you expect the system to do. That's a secure system. So for some reason, we seem to have great difficulty achieving that goal. Here are some numbers for recent, or more or less recent, systems. 40 million lines, 50 million, 100 plus million lines. By my conservative estimate, we're creating bugs faster than we can find them. We have, in a good case, one bug every 1,000 lines. That is pretty hard work. This is when I was writing really small programs like TCP wrapper, which is only 4,000 lines, and I would spend weeks just banging on the software, reading it forward, backwards, running it through its spelling checker, and doing all kinds of silly things to catch mistakes before other people did. And this is a small program, so I could do this. POSIX is 100,000 lines. There's no way that I can do the same thing with POSIX, but when I did have time for this level of quality control, I ended up with about one bug in 1,000 lines. So we have something like 50 million lines a year. If you divide 50 millions by 1 in 1,000, you end up with 50,000 new bugs a year. So even if you read BugTrack every day, there is no way that we have 50,000 new bugs found on BugTrack or any mailing list that discusses vulnerabilities. The number that we're having here is bigger than the number we can find, which also means that not in you or my lifetime will we fix all the bugs that are being written. Because by the time we fix those, there are billions more. Actually, I stole this introduction from a different presentation that I've given only once, and I thought, well, that's such a waste of all the effort I put into this part of the presentation, so I reused the introduction. So the reason that buggy software works, the reasoning goes as follows. You have this piece of software, and all the variables in your software, and the timing, and the configuration, and all these other things, they can have different values. You can give different input to the program. You can configure it a little bit different. And so all these things span a very large space of possible states. And with what happens with software normally is that you build a piece of software, then you try to use it, and then eventually it will work. So you've shaken out some bugs. And then you start using it more, you find more bugs, and you end up after some amount of time with a little area of errors, and inputs that approximately cover normal usage. And so what's called normal use is actually stay within the boundaries of what is known. Here the program behaves as is known, not necessarily as expected, but it behaves as is known. And if you just use it in this way, it will work. And so normal users pick this up and they will never have problems. On the other hand, there are these non-normal users called hackers and intruders who don't play by these rules. They explore the untested areas. And guess what? They find more than one bug every 1,000 lines. They find more than like 10 bugs every 1,000 lines, or maybe 100. And so in this vast area, this picture is not drawn to scale, by the way. So this is really small. This is really big. And so in this vast, wide, unexplored area, there is this enormous source of bugs for people to be found, just waiting to be found. And so this is also why just fixing bugs doesn't really solve the problem, because you find a bug, you fix it, you find another bug, you fix it, you find another bug, you fix it. And you can do this forever. Because there is this vast area of unexplored territory that has these one bug every so many lines. And with billions of lines of code, it's just going to take forever. So this is from a very ancient note on the design of secure military systems, where people already realized that if you really want software that works as expected, you don't just build it and then, you know, shake out the bugs and use it. You actually have to, from the start, be very careful about what you're doing. Okay, so now on my transition into POSIX, strategies to make systems more secure. One strategy is, I have actually asked people, what do you think, would this solve the problem? Make it a million times harder, there will be fewer people writing software, there will be fewer lines, fewer bugs. and things will be good, but you know, this is not happening. And for example, low barrier languages like PHP are enormously popular because you write almost no code and it works, sort of. And the result is that the non-expert programmers outnumber the experts by an increasing margin. So the expert will go extinct. They will become, people will look at you like, you're an expert, I don't trust you, you're dangerous. Non-experts will outnumber us. First versions of code are being tested on the web. Last year I wrote, will be tested live on the web, but that's no longer true. They are being tested. You write a web application, it's already on the web as you're trying to make it work. And buggy software works. I already explained that. So I've been involved a little bit with PHP. PHP is like a scripting language, especially popular for web pages. And it's really easy to make applications that have horrible security holes and it won't tell you. And there's no way for the user to find out. Of course, there are people who are taking money to build systems that will test your web applications and find the bugs, and I guess those people have a right to live too. But it would be nice if the language itself had the means to tell you that you're taking this variable from the web, you're storing it in an SQL query. Don't do that! You need to run it through MySQL, RealEscape, Foobar Mobile, or some other function. And the same thing with echoing back to the web and into Shell Condenser. I built a little extra layer inside the PHP interpreter from Zend.com, and it has 1% overhead, or maybe less. I don't really know exactly, because performance differences at the 1% level are really, really hard to measure, and they change even if you run it on a different CPU, different caches, different details in hardware implementation. But it is possible to eliminate, to help non-expert programmers to some extent, but you shouldn't expect that it's easy to make systems secure. Like, total non-expert programmers should not be writing security critical software, even if they have a system that helps them do it. In any case, yes, we do need a revolution that empowers real users to write like something like Spetses, although Spetses have had their problems. Okay, so the more serious strategy is to be aware that any amount of code that you write will have bugs, and so you actually plan for failure. So build something, it's like if you build a car, you have a seat. That's the central part of the car, and then you have some controls. But then there are these areas around the passenger that are meant to sacrifice themselves in the case of an accident. So you build all these safeties around in the system. You know it needs to be handling failures well. And so planning that is a large part of the effort of building Postex. You plan for error, and of course, building a system that is totally secure but otherwise unusable isn't really the solution. Just like Timo found that he was building his IMAP server, and then he was building an IMAP test suite, and he found that only his own server passed all the tests. I know this feeling because I implemented SMTP way back when from RFC 821, which was the current RFC on SMTP at the time. So SMTP has like four really critical commands: hello, mail from, recipient to, data. Quit. Okay. Five commands, they have a relatively simple syntax. And I implemented my SAP server, and then I exposed it to IBM's internal network. I was like, okay. and then I found already that I couldn't talk to all systems. So you build a system that plays by the rules but can only talk to itself. That's not very useful. Postex said the same thing. So it has to be secure, of course, but it also has to perform better because no one will use it if it is more secure but slower. And it also has to be usable. So it solves my problem, but also solves your problem. To my pleasant surprise, the security architecture has other benefits. So that's where last 4 years ago presentation ended, with the benefits. So now quickly skip over through this part. As you know, some of you know, really old people, that the traditional Unix mail architecture is monolithic. Well, two monolithic systems, sendmail, the big monolithic part, and binmail, a smaller monolithic part. And they divide the work between them. There is the binmail program is for local submissions, but also for mailbox deliveries. And then there is the sendmail, bigger monolithic component that actually decides where to deliver mail. And it does a few more things. It also executes commands and appends to file names if the user has a .forward file. And binmail writes to a mailbox file, which is owned by the recipient. So this is a really old 1970s mail system model. And the problem with this approach is that these programs both, at some point of execution, need super user privileges. Binmail needs it so they can write my message into someone else's mailbox, and sendmail needs it, among other things, so they can receive mail from the network and execute a command in my.forward file. No one else should be able to do that, but the mail system should. And so these things, impersonating a recipient is a privileged operation. And so that's why it needs root privilege. And if you have monolithic software, one large program that does all these things, then the whole program runs as root, which is problematic if you try to implement things like damage control. With postfix, well, this is what you get when you don't have damage control. With postfix, the primary thing was damage control. So shit happens, and we need to make sure that it doesn't do too much, doesn't do more damage than needs to be done. And so I broke up postfix into parts that are more or less divided as there are input programs. And so it was a little bit modeled after internet routers. Routers have different interfaces for inputs and outputs, and different interfaces also have different encapsulations. So for network, the encapsulation is SMTP. For local submission, it's Unix text lines, and on the outside, it's the opposite. But different things have different encapsulations. On the inside of the mail system, it's all in a standardized format that only appears inside of postfix. Okay. So this is with damage control. The first damage control is to confine the system privileges only to the small, to the few small programs that actually need it. You don't need root privileges to write mail to the network, and so it doesn't have root privileges and it never gets it. So that's the first principle is least privilege. Break it up into smaller programs. The second one is when you build a system from small programs, you still have to be really careful about what you're doing. And so the rest is be careful in your design, in your implementation, and make sure that each program is relatively paranoid. When it gets something from the network, it's especially paranoid. But even when these programs are talking to each other, they don't just simply believe what the other guy is saying. There are all kinds of checks. If something is wrong, coding errors or system errors or user errors, the error doesn't propagate too far and doesn't do too much damage. Okay. POSIX was influenced by a bunch of systems. The first one was the TIS firewall with the infamously problematic SMAPD programs. This is 1993, so there are not a lot of people in the room who remember this, but it was the first open source network internet firewall. It was written by Marcus Rainham, and it was a solid piece of software, but it did have some problems, and especially the mail component was, it would just stop working occasionally, and so you had to babysit it, kind of. But it implemented the principles of least privilege, a change root jail, no file system access beyond what is needed, and an air gap between receiving and delivering processes. So I took that part from the TIS firewall. There are definitely ideas from QMail. Breaking up the system by itself is not, well, it was unusual at the time, but the way it is broken up is pretty obvious once you start thinking about it. What QMail made performing very well was the parallel deliveries. It also has a mail deer format. You heard the previous speaker talk about mail deers. Mail deer is one file per message, and just for historical correctness, I mentioned that the one file per message store was actually from 1997 or so, the MH mail system. There is an online webpage that I can refer people to if they want to. Apache inspired parts of postfix with the master daemon, where postfix forks off daemon processes on demand. If there is no activity, then you don't have an SMTP listener. But if something connects to the SMTP port, POSIX will fork off an SMTPD process. And once that process is done, it doesn't exit immediately, but it will try to be several times. So in the days of 75 megahertz Pentium CPUs, that was well, it's a big win if you didn't have to fork an exec in the program for every SMTP connection. Nowadays, it's not such a big deal, but it's just a good idea not to be wasteful about resources. I stole the standard user interface because I wanted to be more or less drop-in compatible, and I talked about classical routers already. Okay, how are we doing time-wise? This chart shows one aspect of postfix and other mail system evolution. 4 years ago, I presented it, and it was just here. And I kind of childishly claimed victory because I had passed sendmail in lines of code. Was not clear how whether sendmail would we would get into kind of a race or something, but we didn't. What happened is that postfix was in 2005. It was in the middle of a spurt where I added a lot of things that should have been added several years ago. There was something with IP version 6 and some other things. So this is this growth spurt. And by 2006, I was getting signals that I should reduce my effort on postfix a little bit and start working on other things. So I increased my effort instead and finished it. And by the middle of 2006, I declared postfix as feature complete. I was in, and then just to prove that I actually wrote less new code, you can see that the graph of postfix flattens off, and it's pretty much the same slope as the sendmail graph. It's like half the slope of most of its life. So what happens in reality is, of course, I write fewer lines of code, but I just put more functionality into them. It's just, you know. And as it turns out to be, if you're short on resources, you actually come up with better solutions. I remember this from TCP wrapper days. I didn't know anything about TCP IP programming, but there was this guy breaking into a computer, so I had to do something that would tell me he's doing FTP, telnet thing, and all these things to your machine. And all I could do was write this 20-line program that exactly did what I needed. It told me there's a telnet from here, or an FTP from there, or a finger from there. That was because 20 lines was all I could do. And I will run into another 20-line example later in my presentation. The security architecture initially was like build it as many small programs, keep them away from privileges. It also helped me to keep the system good because it has, as you've seen in the previous graph, it went from 20,000 lines to 100,000 lines if you remove the comments. Normally when a system expands by a factor of 5, it doesn't get better. It's really hard to change a system and not mess it up. Timo, previous speaker, went through a complete rewrite because he was trying to put more stuff into Dovecot, and he was just getting into problems because the system couldn't be updated. I am kind of avoiding this problem by doing small features as a little change in one of the programs, and if it's a really big feature, I just add a whole program for it, and a little client-server interface in the rest of the system. So those things are good for stability. A whole program, if you don't use it, then it will never run, and so it can't really destroy your security or its stability. The present breakdown of postfix is 23 daemon programs and 13 commands. That's a lot more than it started with, and there will be more by the end of the presentation. Interesting. I thought that, you notice how these fonts don't completely correctly work out. This was written with Microsoft PowerPoint and is being rendered with Microsoft PowerPoint. I would expect this with OpenOffice, where you have almost perfect emulation, but not quite. But really surprising. Anyway, adding antivirus. So I missed all the presentation on Exim, but here I will explain why POSIX is not like Exim in this respect. In 1999, I had an unpleasant surprise. I'm a Unix guy, I write on Unix systems, and my programs run Unix systems, and I never have to worry about Windows viruses because they don't run on Unix. So that's good. Life is good. And then suddenly, POSIX was, by this time, POSIX had been around for 2 years or more, and it was so what happens is when you write a new piece of software, people pick it up. It will be picked up by a particular kind of community of people. And POSIX was not picked up by departmental groupware servers. It was picked up by people who run the infrastructure at large companies. So these are the people who buy a machine, they throw off the OS, or at least most of the, they throw out bind, they throw out sendmail, they throw out all this stuff. They install the latest bind, they install the latest POSIX, and a few other things, the latest Apache or whatever. And so these are the heavy lifting machines that are sitting at the entrance of the corporation and that are running the backbone, not at IBM. And so those are the places where POSIX made its inroads. And these people were also very quickly confronted with the problem of Melissa worms going around. And one of these people, Lamont Jones from HP, wrote a small feature called header checks that was used to stop Melissa's signature header, I don't know if it was a subject or something else, I love you or whatever, stop it on the border of the corporation instead of having all this mail going around and around and around. So that was a short-term fix. And it's also the worst feature in POSIX, and Lamont admits it, it's the worst feature in POSIX, but everybody complains about it and it's not going to be fixed. The long-term solution was not to build antivirus into POSIX, because I wasn't going to really do that. And I didn't think that it made sense to try to do two such different things. I mean, this is not how society makes progress. Society makes progress by specialization. I could bake my own bread, and I could make my own shoes. I could make my own clothes, but it wouldn't look as good. And the food and the bread would not be as good. It's much more economical if some people specialize, they become bakers, they become shoemakers, and they make clothes. And so I make mail systems that I don't do antivirus because other people can do it better. And I'm not too ashamed to admit this. So with the emergence of all these protocols, CVP, I don't know if it still exists, Content Vectoring Protocol, there was all this stuff that people were inventing, and I thought, well, do I really want to build all this into POSIX? We're already using SMTP to get mail from A to B. Why can't we get it? Use SMTP to get mail from B to the antivirus system? If it's good enough for one thing, why not for the other? And so that's the path that I took. Don't use protocols that only work with POSIX or only with some systems. SMTP is good enough. It's a simple protocol. It's easy to implement. at least the errors in how people implement SMTP are well understood. So this is the POSIX architecture that I proposed. You have POSIX receiving mail via SMTP or other ways, and then it uses SMTP to give it to the filter. The filter does something, and then it gives it via SMTP to POSIX, and then we're done. And so red is dirty, green is clean. It's really not rocket science, but it took a lot of effort to convince people that this was actually a sensible thing to do. Except that here I made a little mistake. When you look at this, you have two mail servers. That is wasteful. You have two mail servers and something in between. And so what I ended up doing was, in hindsight, what I did was I took two mail systems and folded them together. So it's the same mail system. Mail goes in here, it goes into the queue, Then there's an SMTP client that delivers the mail to the filter, and then it comes back into the same mail system, into the same mail queue, and then it goes out via SMTP. And so you can kind of expect that this SMTP server will have a different configuration from this one. And that's what makes POSIX configuration harder than it should be, because having two different personalities in one mail system configuration into one set of config files is straining what a lot of system administrators can handle. It's easy to make mistakes when you do this. And so it's one of the frequent questions has to do with setting an option for this SMTP server, but having it take effect here, and suddenly POSIX behave in an unexpected way. But in any case, so I fixed that in the next slide. So the advantage of using SMTP after you store mail in your queue is that you have compatibility. A lot of products have SMTP support, and especially a few years after I promoted this with POSIX, pretty much every mail system, inspection system, had some sort of SMTP support. And it didn't really have to be good SMTP support, it just had to be good enough. SMTP is simple, workarounds are understood, and implementation errors are also well understood. Performance was also good. You don't need to run one. Content filter processes are large and slow and heavy. They use up lots of disk space and lots of memory as they do things. And if you run it early in your chain while you're receiving mail, then you're running all these monstrous processes, one per SMTP client, and you make yourself very vulnerable to DOS. And with running the filter after the queue between two mail systems, you eliminate that problem. You can get better utilization. And finally, you do lose some context information by the time the mail reaches the filter via SMTP. It's one hop away from the network, so it doesn't really have all the information that the original mail server had. And so there are some clues just to pass that information along. I think I figured out what the problem is. See the dash here again? Just distracts me. I don't think I'm using a lot of these. I hope I won't. So this is the final recommended version. POSIX now supports multiple instances. You can type POSIX start or POSIX stop, and a whole bunch of POSIXes come to life, or they go away. But you can also manipulate them individually when you have to. But typically, in this case, when you say POSIX start, you would expect both of them to come up, or both of them to go down with POSIX start. So this is a lot easier. It's not yet propagated into all the documentation, so there is a multi-instance README file that has some examples for this. One of the benefits is that typically every machine runs a very stupid null client configuration for itself, local cron jobs and all that stuff. You don't want to use these guys for local cron jobs. You use a local null client POSIX for that. And those things are a lot simpler now than they were. Okay. One more dash. There was also, when I made my notes, and yes, the user is not always right, is what I wrote here. So there's a lot of demand for running the POSIX filters while mail is received. One of the good things of this is that if the filter says reject, POSIX can tell it to the client, it doesn't have to send a bounce message. The dark side of filtering after receiving mail is, what do you do when the mail gets rejected? You don't have the problem here, you just pass the reject reply back to the client, and the client either just gives up because it's a spam bot, it doesn't really want to deliver the bounce back to whoever the originator is. If it's a real client, then it will send the bounce message to the user and they will figure it out. So this is the pass-through POSIX before queue inspection. It has the cost of one filter per SMTP client. Every connection with SMTP means you run your filter, and it hits your machine. So you can't really scale your machine up to thousands of connections so easily. You would also be running thousands of content filters, which is usually not practical. It's less scalable, but there were users who really insisted on this, so I have implemented it, even if the user is not always right. Okay, de facto standards. How am I doing time-wise? So far, I added content inspection capability to POSIX by adopting a protocol that I had already implemented called SMTP. So that was not too hard. I could basically let other people do the work, and that was good. It has worked. There are lots of appliances and systems that people don't even know have POSIX in them, but they have POSIX in them and they have this kind of setup using SMTP for content inspection. This is a later stage where I was adding another thing. And I don't really know why I call this. Oh, it says anti-spam virus. Yes, this was mostly about anti-spam, but it had a benefit for antivirus. In 2005, there was a proliferation of email authentication protocols, sender ID, domain keys, DKIM, SPF, and a bunch of other obscure ones. And the end is probably not in sight because people are still bitching about the fine details of DKIM. I joined the mailing list after the sender ID debacle, and people are still bitching about details of DKIM. I don't know why. It should be simple, but they try to make it too hard. So the problem with protocols like these is that you could use an SMTP-based filter, just like the content filters that I showed in the past, but it gets kind of clumsy. You don't really have the original client context, you really don't want to sign the wrong mail, and you want to verify. So for this I decided that tighter integration with the mail system was desirable, but I didn't want to build all these guys into POSIX, especially because they were still changing by the year, and there was no clear winner at the time. So don't build it into POSIX, makes no sense, especially if you have things like Red Hat Enterprise and other distributions that just run several years behind. So even if I were to build it into the MTA, by the time it reaches those people, it's already obsolete. So the solution was to use a plugin interface, and I stole the SendMailMilter interface here. The benefit of SendMailMilter was they already had tools for sender ID and domain keys and DKIM, which I didn't have to write. And there was a whole collection of other applications that people were already using, and hopefully they could use them also with POSIX. Now, building Milters into POSIX is a little bit of a challenge because Milter is a mail filtering protocol that is written for sendmail. So you have this monolithic sendmail program that sends things to the Milter, such as connect, halo, mail recipient data. And it also sends things like the header and the body of the email message. And in POSIX, these things are actually implemented by different programs. SMTP protocol is spoken here, and once the SMTP is removed, I end up with something that has headers and bodies, that's this program. And so this program does these things. And then I have the mail queue. So I had to find a way to make the Milter application speak to both in a way that the Milter didn't know it was being spoofed. But it works. There are a few, the effort was heroic, yes. A few tiny details here. If it's a local submission, you don't have any SMTP at all. So you have to actually fake the SMTP protocol, because these programs only work if they receive the whole sequence of SMTP events. You can't just skip over some of them. It's very strict. So in that case, I have to actually fake some SMTP events here. But it works. And It was a heroic event effort because of the way that the protocol is spread out. But it after, I think, POSIX release by POSIX 2.6, this was new. By POSIX 2.7, it worked very well. And I haven't had problems since. So in return for implementing SendMail Milter support, I received an award in 2006. SendMail was having its 25th birthday. And in California, unfortunately, I was on vacation at the time. So they held three ceremonies. There was one in California, one in London. That's the one that I attended, and one in Tokyo. That was too far away. So I traveled to London, my shortest trip to London, 24 hours. It's not right. London deserves better. But you can do it in one day. It was a morning ceremony, so after the morning ceremony I flew back. But it was fun. There was Eric Ullman talking about history of SendMail. He also, I think it's on the web somewhere, he also talked about the future of email to the point that TCP/IP gets implemented over intergalactic distances and you get, well, TCP/IP is a protocol that works, it's a two-way protocol, so you can't just, if you scale it up, you need bigger windows and you need heat rate timers and all these things. So the protocols tend to have a range of operability, and if you go to galactic distances, what timeouts do you set? You know, it just doesn't get very practical. It's already minutes going to the sun, and the Earth is one of the inner planets, so, you know, the first mail server on Pluto. So these things, this was fun. And, now the light stuff begins. I have 30 minutes left. Okay, I'll just... There are lots of surveys on things like web servers. Netcraft has been doing this for years, and they just connect to many web servers and they look at the kind of technology that runs there, and then they make statistics and they show you their numbers. With mail servers, it's really hard to do it right. And I'm showing you this because POSIX looks good in it. But you can do other measurements in which POSIX looks not so good compared to this one. So, for example, how do you find out what mail servers are running? What these people did was they were in the market for selling an email security product. So they were looking for companies and that they could sell something that would run on their internet-facing gateway in order to keep spam and other stuff out. And so what they did was they bought a list of 400,000 company domains, and then they connected to all those domains, and they looked up what are these companies running on their internet-facing gateways. And this is the breakdown that they found, because they weren't really interested in selling software to machines on the inside of the network. They were really looking at the border gateways. And they find that 15% is unknown, and other is 20%. The artist just left it out of the pie chart because it wouldn't look so good. And then you end up with 12% SendMail, 8.6 POSIX, and so on. Postini is a service provider. Microsoft Exchange, not. MXLogic, another service provider. Qmail is a mail system, Exim is a mail system, then you have another couple other. Barracuda is a product, and Concentric Hosting, I think, was also a service provider where you send all your email there and they will clean it. So this shows that SendMail has the largest market share, not as large as it had 10, 12 years ago, but still dominant, and POSIX was getting close. So that's nice. You can also measure market share by connecting to every IP address. Takes a while. And then port 25 and see what replies. And those are the kind of tests that Bernstein, Qmail's author, did more than 12 years ago now. And he finds that a totally different distribution, but that's, of course, he's looking at random little boxes. And these guys are looking at serious infrastructure. I think Exim is the default mail system on several Linux distributions, and so by count of systems, Exim is bigger than it is represented here. But, anyway, so this was from 2007. I also remember that there was a query on the Postfix mailing list, trends.google.com, and if you type in send mail, Postfix, cube, Exim, then you get these graphs. And the graphs show you the relative volume of queries for sendmail versus postfix versus qmail versus the other guy. So people type queries into Google and Google goes find the answers. This is statistics on the Google queries themselves, the query strings. And so by this query, you see that things are up and down. There are certain things like elections here. November 2006, was it? And another election in November 2008. So suddenly people get interested in other things and less in email. But it looks like Postfix is getting a larger share of the queries. Note also that Exim is almost constant throughout. And Exim is one of those names that you don't easily confuse with anything else, whereas Postfix is a name that could be other things. So the result is a time distribution. Okay. But it's really nice if you you type the name of your school and the other school, or your company and the other company, and you just see how the numbers change. That's really interesting. So this is looking. Well, Postfix is a common name, common term like prefix, postfix, infix. And if you try this, then you see that they all have completely different behaviors. And I still don't know what it really means. And when I tweak the query further, just to eliminate some of the collisions and confusions, I say sendmail server, postfix server, then we're really sure that people were talking about postfix as the mail system, not postfix as something else. And then you see that the lines are also crossing over. So, but they here we're really tweaking the queries, and I don't really know. Oops, I think the battery is gone again. Yes. So I still don't really know what the statistics mean, but they're funny pictures, and it's nice to speculate about what it means. And until somebody does a real serious upside down, reversed.
No.
What?
I will get some.
Okay. So until somebody does a serious infrastructure analysis like several slides ago, we will not know what the numbers are. The answer is only as good as the query you ask, the question you ask. And the other thing, you see all these lines sloping down over time. It means that most people are interested in other things. Most people have a life. Mail system people don't have a life. And the proportion is this declining too. It's a sobering observation. Recent developments. I will race through this, making sure I don't. Okay, go ahead.
Next try.
Oops. So, as released way back when, Postfix was. Implemented a subset of all the things that people expect to find in a mail system. And I added some major features over time. So when I gave my talk 4 years ago, Postfix already did IP version 6 and a few other things. Standardized delivery status notifications was a major feature in Postfix 2.3. Bounce message templates, people really wanted to change the text of Postfix's, sorry, I couldn't deliver your mail. I don't know why they would want to change that. But typical use is to have the native language and English. And so once I implemented the templates, it was actually easy to make some changes. If you have used Postfix a long time ago, you will remember that the bounce message says, this is the POSIX mail system at foo.example.com. Sorry, your mail couldn't go through, blah, blah, blah. Send mail to Postmaster. And I would get all these email messages from people who said, POSIX cannot deliver my mail. And then I would get their bounce message like, and or they would get bounce messages for mail that they didn't send, and I have to educate these people about, well, it wasn't POSIX that created this email, this mail was created by a spammer and they used your name, and POSIX is only the messenger of the news, please don't shoot the messenger. And this got really tedious. So having the templates, I think by the second iteration of the templates, I killed off this is the POSIX mail system. I said, this is the mail system. Don't send me your bounces, please. So I mostly removed POSIX from the text in the return email because I'm just getting annoyed. And it apparently was showing my annoyance in the replies to these people. Because not good. Milton support, I mentioned that already. Originally in POSIX 2.4, 2.3, and in 2.4 I added some missing pieces. And then SendMail changed their implementation. They had more features, so I catch up in 5. And now I'm in 2.6, I have most of the SendMail features again. Dkim is the main reason I implemented Milton support into POSIX. And it also does the before queue filtering. Okay. More recent developments. Scalability. POSIX, for the people who have looked underneath, POSIX would use Select. Select is an ancient BSD kernel interface for monitoring lots of file descriptors. And it's okay for doing things up to 30 descriptors or so, but it's not okay if you do things of like monitoring 1,000 connections. It gets slow. And so I implemented support for these faster alternatives in 2.4. And so now you can have thousands of connections on one POSIX machine, and if your kernel actually has all the tables to do this, then it will work. Small office, home office support, people who have very restrictive email acceptable use policies, they can send only so many emails per day or per hour or per minute. Multiple instance support is simplifies content filters. There's also the null client, which means that every server has this really tiny null client, even if it runs a big gateway server on the same box, it uses the simple one for the cron jobs. And stress adaptive behavior, that is going to be the rest of my presentation. Yes. If you recall, I have had this experience. You wake up one day and suddenly things are not the same way. I wrote Unix software running on Unix systems, never worry about Windows virus, and suddenly your mail system is just pumping around Windows viruses by the bazillions. And so you have to do something about it. In 2009, I had a similar experience. I built a mail system, high power, it's secure, it runs well, and it has amazing performance. And then I find that the mail system is spending almost all its time not delivering mail. That sucks. You build this system that high-powered, you know, you have this high-powered vehicle, and you just go shopping for it. Shopping with it. It's not right. So I finally did something about it. First, a few observations. This is the only pie chart, so don't worry. But I think pie charts are appropriate for this thing. According to a Message Labs annual report from 2008, 81% of email is spam and 90% is from botnets. Actually, the number is down. It was 82% in 2007. So it's just a little down, not much. But it means that, so this is the part of email that POSIX actually was built for. This is the part that it's supposed to be working on. And all this is stuff that I actually would like to keep away from POSIX because it's just noise and it drags down performance. But I, you know, I have all these other things to do. And by the time that 2007 came, I had to spring into action. Because in 2007 there was the Storm botnet. Storm was a very prolific peer-to-peer, multi-tier, personal compliant botnet. It also had a way of sending email, but the mail client was very buggy. Didn't I mention when Timo was speaking that misbehaving other software frequently sometimes exposes bugs in your own system? Well, so this is not really a bug in POSIX, but it was something that needed to be addressed anyway. The Storm botnet would connect to a mail server from x.x.x.x, and POSIX would reject the mail. No way that you were going to send your mail into my system. And notice the clocks. So there is 15 hours and 60 minutes, and 5 minutes later, nothing has happened, and POSIX disconnects the client. So this means that the client connects to POSIX, it tries to send an email, POSIX says go away, and then the client just does nothing for 5 minutes or longer. I don't know how long it would have waited, but after 5 minutes, POSIX gives up. And the 5 minutes is because RFC, at the time, 821, but 5321, the latest, still recommends a 5 minute server side timeout. And if you have clients like this, you don't really want to spend 5 minutes on them. But POSIX implements the standard. And the result is that all your SMTP ports are kept busy by clients. I try to picture it like this. You have all these legitimate and not so legitimate connections are queuing up in the kernel because POSIX is only handling a fixed number of sessions. The default is 100, which is plenty even if you're handling lots of mail, but when you have these 5 minute do nothing zombies, then you just won't have enough, you'll never have enough because they will all be just sitting there and doing nothing. So that was the problem, and then something had to be done about it. I could no longer ignore the fact that POSIX was just spending 80-90% of its time not delivering mail. The symptoms were like clients connect to the server and nothing happens until one of these guys goes away and they get a chance, lost connections and all these things, no more. Okay. So the strategy for temporary overload is what I implemented first. Zombies aren't doing this all the time, it's just temporary. Work faster, effectively, don't wait 5 minutes. It would be nice if POSIX would adjust the timeouts on the load conditions, and so that's what I implemented. If it is in an overload condition, you can reduce the time limits. If it is not in an overload, it will do the RFC recommended 5 minute time limits, which is really insane, but make sure that you have no excuse, other people have no excuse for not being able to send you mail because you implement the 5 minute timeout. So if you go to shorter timeouts, like or maybe 10 seconds, most mail systems will still be able to communicate because they don't really need 10 seconds to make up. What did I say? I said hello, now I need to say mail from? Okay, don't need 10 seconds to make up your mind about doing these things. So most mail goes through, but some mail systems are handicapped in some way and they will eventually not get through because they need 50 seconds to do something before they can send the next command. These mail systems are misconfigured, but things happen. And so all these shorter timeouts are okay if you have a temporary overload because the overload goes away, then your handicapped clients can connect again and do their 50 second thinking time between commands and they will just get through fine. It's on by default in POSIX to 6, an option, it's built in POSIX to 5 last year, and patches for POSIX to 3 and to 4. So I'm actually supporting 5 versions of POSIX concurrently. The way it works is that an SMTP daemon process is invoked either in this way or in this way. Ugly, isn't it? 21 lines. Didn't have a lot of time. Sorry. This is my second 12-line 21-line program. But It is very effective normally, and okay, so this is where it gets really ugly, but these are the defaults. When there is no stress, which is the green line up there, then POSIX will use this 100 seconds for 300 seconds for SMTPD timeout, which is 5 minutes, and some other error limits. If it's overload time, then we're just going, you know, pretty strict. If you don't say something for 10 seconds, you're gone. If you make more than one mistake in an SMTP session, you're out. And you can't just keep saying no op, just to keep the connection busy. You really have to make mail transactions, otherwise you're gone. This, of course, is permissible only under emergency conditions, but it works, and it was good enough to give me some time to start thinking about the longer-term solution. The longer-term solution is to have a way of dealing with persistent overload. It is conceivable that there will be more zombies sending email, and at some point all your SMTP ports will constantly be saying no, go away. And I don't really want to use up all my SMTP server slots doing this. So either you can configure lots and lots and lots of SMTP server slots saying no, go away. Or you put something in front of the mail system that tries to keep those mailbots away. And that's what I tried to do over the last 2 weeks. The idea is not completely original. OpenBSD has a program called SpamD, which is essentially a program before the mail system. Mail Channels actually has a commercial product that does this and a few other interesting things. And Michael Tokarev, one of the PostFix users' mailing list contributors, did a similar thing 7-8 years ago when his mail server was completely swamped by zombies and botnets. And so he put a program in front that was handling like 30,000 connections at the same time. And only a few of those would actually be allowed to talk to PostFix. And so that's the basic idea what happens here. I have a program with a name that is probably going to change because PostScreen is not the right name. It takes all the connections from good and bad guys, and it tries to throw out most of the bad guys so that the mail system will be talking mostly to legitimate mail systems. So one of the things it looks at is remote DNS block lists. It has a local whitelist. If you go through all this testing, because these things take time. You don't want to do this. One reason you don't want to do this in PostFix is it takes time. You tie up your SMTP server all the time. It's doing DNS lookups and other things. So if I do it in here, I'm just wasting this program's time, and it's very little. It does the DNS lookups. It does a few other things. And if the client passes it, it's stored. I'm not going to delay the client again for 24 hours. So that's what it does. It has a fast path and slow path architecture to make sure that the performance is good. It accepts a connection. Is it whitelisted? Hands off to the real SMTP server. And the latency is 0.1 millisecond or less. It's the margin of error. I could not measure precise enough. I've had this problem before. And multi-core systems really stink if you try to do performance measurements, because it really depends on if you do a program that makes lots of system calls, you go program, kernel, program, kernel, program, kernel, kernel, kernel. And so depending on where does the program get to run on the same CPU again, maybe now it runs on here, now it runs here, and the kernel here, and here, and here. And so depending on how things bounce around between CPUs, when you do measurements like this, you get relatively large margins of errors. You don't really know what performs. So I developed this on a uniprocessor machine where I didn't have these problems. But the numbers are for a multiprocessor system, because that's what most people use nowadays. So the fast path is fast enough. It can handle lots and lots and lots of connections. But if a client is not whitelisted, then it goes into the torture room. I send a greeting to the client, and then I start doing all kinds of things. I do DNS lookups here, like 4 DNS looks in parallel. I also see if the client starts talking by itself, which is not a good thing. And if it fails the test, I can either drop the client or pass it. So this has been running on several servers in the past 1.5 weeks. And so it has been running in this mode mostly, because I didn't want people to drop their mail, because I was doing an experiment. But if it passes, it goes into whitelist, and the next time the client will just be helped instantly. Code name post screen, but it will change. It's one of these non-production postfix snapshot, which means it's the same code as the regular postfix with a little add-on. So that's it. It's one daemon process. It's completely different from the rest of postfix, where I use one process for an SMTP connection, because if this process crashes, I lose one SMTP connection, I don't lose all of them. In this case, it's one process that talks to, oh no, tens of thousands of SMTP clients, and I don't want to use tens of thousands of processes for doing stupid things. So it's one. So it has to be built a little bit more robust. It does detect clients that start talking too soon, and that's kind of fun, so I will show more. Lookups of DNS, not a proxy, because it needs to be fast and simple. And it doesn't do any SMTP at all, but I plan to add a mini SMTP engine, so if I drop a client, I can still speak enough of the protocol, I can figure out what was he trying to send from this to this. Then the usual postfix reject logs that gives you an idea of what was going on. Yes?
Just a short question about the fast path cache. Do you store it in memory or on a local file system?
Local file system.
And then it's still open 1 millisecond?
Yes, because computers have lots of memory.
Okay. So you use the cache, the DFS cache?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and also, some clients come in bursts. The same client connects a few times, then it helps. Okay, pre-greet detection. There was years ago on the postfix mailing list a discussion about some of these bots connect to your machine and they start sending email immediately. And so could you please build a 1 second delay into postfix or 2 second delay into postfix? You receive the connection. Wait for 1 or 2 seconds and then start doing SMTP. And I didn't like the idea because it meant every connection gets slowed down by 1 or 2 seconds, which means that your system can handle less mail. So I didn't do it. This is what normally a good client does. The server sends this and the client sends this. SendMail did implement the wait before sending. And it doesn't, so I tried it in postfix and it didn't work very well. What I found was if I wait 5 or 10 seconds, some clients will spontaneously send quit after 5 seconds. I don't know why 5. And then they disconnect. And some clients just hang up without sending anything after 7 seconds. But the results didn't impress me. And so I took a slightly different approach. But this is good SMTP. You don't want to build it into the server itself because you're hurting yourself with those delays more. Question, how do you find out if a house has a dog? You just, stand near the house and listen until something barks. But that can take a long time. How do you find out if the house has a dog and you're in a hurry? Just ring the bell and it will bark immediately. And so that's what I do in postfix. I use a multi-lane server greeting. If you're familiar with SMTP, you will know that a dash after the number means there's another line coming. So in this case, the greeting is this line, followed by this line, and then the client is supposed to respond. And with post screen, I only send this line, and the spam bot talks immediately. And I know this is a bot. And the result for Charité.de, which is in Hamburg, I think, shows you that 50% of all the zombies is a pre-greeter. That's pretty impressive. Also, 90% of them are blocklisted with Spamhaus, so it's not like this is immediately going to reduce your spam volume, but who knows? Maybe Spamhaus will stop providing such a good quality of service. If you can almost for free detect 50% of all the bots, then that's a pretty good deal. And 100 millisecond round-trip time, so they receive your 220- greeting, the half, the first part of a multi-line, and then they reply, and they all reply within this 100 millisecond round-trip time window, which is just about the distance to the US and several other parts. Yes?
But this is just a snapshot, so if the botnet times gets better, yeah, you can just implement it correctly, and that's it.
Yeah. No, but the problem with botnets is that they are in a hurry. They are really in a hurry. They get paid for numbers of deliveries. Yes, if they become fully SMTP compliant, then this trick will no longer work. But they have, you know, they have incentives to cut corners in the protocol. And this is one of the corners, and this is not the only corner that I could detect. After Halo, they can, at any protocol stage, they can misbehave, and I could detect this. This is from 1 week of spam traffic. But it's quite a lot. And I was doing some numbers. Oh, yeah. So of all the pre-greeters, most of these are Russian, by the way. Yes?
Was any legitimate MTA distracted by this continuation?
Half. There is a mail server testing tool that just pings your server and then sends quit. Just to give you a status of your server is alive or not. Mailbox test or something. And this tool will actually answer after the first of the two-line greetings. That's the only one that we are aware of. So 80% of the Russian bots is a pre-greeter. And 84% of the Ukraine bots. And then the numbers are much lower for the other ones. You can also use it to discriminate countries, I guess. some of the bots hang up immediately, and I don't know why. I suppose it is a port scanning kind of thing, enough to find out that there is a server running. I also know that they hang up before they can see the server's welcome banner, because my machine at home has a 25 millisecond uplink latency. And the hang-up happens before things could have gone around. And there's a little bump here, which is maybe hang-ups after seeing the greeting banner. Okay. Relative block lists. Porcupine is my own machine. It has about 40 times as little email as this one. But they both have the similar distribution for block listing. Zen has the largest share, and then Barracuda does a pretty good job, and these guys are more conservative. But if you're confident that Spamhaus is good, then you can stop a lot of things just by using them. The following stats are based on Spamhaus rankings. If Zen Spamhaus says that this is a spam, then I count it. And you see that Caritas.de is in Hamburg, Python.org is in Amsterdam, so they're both in Europe. They both have similar volumes of spam. It's either 86,000 connections a day or 95. It's not really a major difference. What is also noticeable that most of them are from Russia, but Russia is this large country that spans the whole continent. And then all the other ones are just about the same thing. So you have this distribution that has a very, very long tail. And I show you only a small portion of it. Okay. Okay. This is Python. The same week. Notice that you get spam during all hours of the day, but it's coming from different parts of the world at different times. Russians are particularly during this part of the day, and so the dip for Russians is about here, 3 a.m. Eastern Central. Of course, Russia is a little to the east, so for them, this is much later. And then you have India with the peak of activity here. India is like 5 hours to the east, so this is actually 5 hours later in India. USA dips here, but USA is 6 hours away from Central Europe, so this is actually 4 or 5 in the morning in the US. So all these patterns have this daily, regular daily, more or less regular daily variation where different counties are active at different times of the day, and it really corresponds to, well, what's day and what's night in those countries. Unfortunately, this means that you can't really distinguish spam from real email easily, because most real email will also be in these peaks. Most real email won't be sent like here. Okay, well, I think it's the last one. Just to show you that the statistics aren't always as nice, that these huge peaks, there must have been some spam runs in here, and I haven't really dug into the data. This is lots of data, by the way. Looks like small pictures, but lots of connections and stuff. But again, there's this variation between day and night, and they have just different temporal distributions. So these are all, the last things I've shown are just data that I collected in the last week or so. Oh, this says there. And with a program that is sitting in front of, well, that was not good. Excuse me. Yes. It's a little program that is currently totally experimental, but it's stable enough that it can be used on production servers. And it's mostly used right now to collect information about what this traffic looks like. It helps keep away a lot of junk from the server. You hopefully get more legitimate connections. You don't have to put an expensive appliance in front of POSIX. And that's it. So to conclude my presentation, if you're 13 years into a project, you notice certain things. You make one mistake early on, and the mistake punishes you. It punishes you again. It gets back at you. Every time I add something to POSIX, I like to keep the existing installations working. That makes testing a little harder, and programming also a little bit harder, because you really want to make sure that people can make the forwards and backwards migration without losing their mail. So it's very nice that people can upgrade their, in most of the cases, people can upgrade POSIX and not even have to shut it down. The release notes will tell you if you have to, but usually don't even have to do that. There's compatibility on the outside. There is an appliance called Cisco PIX, for which there are truly gross, horrible workarounds in POSIX. And I haven't actually tested this code in about 5 years, so I don't even know if it works. And the problem is, it still works? God, it's still needed?
Sometimes.
That sucks. That's the other problem. There's all these features, and Timo was talking about all these extra code paths in his Dovecot server where he tries to recover from errors. But this is code that is really hard to test. And I remember Babe Quinn having an error variable in POSIX that I can change the settings to trigger deep internal errors way back down in the engine that I couldn't really trigger otherwise. But testing is a real pain, and so if you can get rid of some of these features, then it will definitely simplify development. There's external compatibility and internal compatibility. Configuration parameters are also something. POSIX has evolved, but some of the defaults still reflect 1998 days, and they are totally inappropriate, but they're still there for compatibility, and that will have to go at some point. because even I'm supposed to know how POSIX work, but occasionally I will give an answer on the mailing list and it will be wrong because there are these invisible default settings that I forgot about. POSIX Lite is something that I've mentioned. It would be make it simpler. Don't try to support certain things forever and make it more pluggable. If I can solve a problem by making it someone else's problem, then it's no longer my problem. That doesn't sound nice. And so there are almost two almost diverging schools at work here. In XM, the direction is to build it into XM, make it a really nice mail system because all these things are built in. There was even a presentation on how to do anti-spam without doing Amavis. Just bare XM. And in the case of POSIX, I'm trying to avoid this very explicitly. I think Mark can do a better job than I on that, and that other people can do a better job on those things. I don't make my own shoes, and I don't make my own clothes, and I don't bake my own bread, because other people can do a better job. So if I can make it pluggable, the pain, of course, is that somebody needs to put those pieces together. And if the result system is unwieldy, then we haven't really made progress. So that's a challenge. How do you make it pluggable, make it still easy for people to use? And I'm almost out of time now. We started late, so I have to. Don't reinvent systems. Inventions are painful. There are not a lot of good inventions. So by necessity, many inventions are not as good. So if you don't invent, then you don't contribute to the large pile of not so good inventions. So what I try to do is try to use things that work, invent sparingly. And in the trade-off between internal and external, I build the stable protocols into the system and all the other stuff, the stuff that is constantly changing, is plugged in. It also means that the mail system itself, you don't really have to replace PostFix, at least, last year I screwed up on Linux. But normally, you can run the same PostFix for 4 years and it won't make a difference. You can run it for 5 years if you're on a BSD machine or six. And it will still work fine because it's not like the software gets worse over years because people find dozens and dozens of bugs in it. So it's nice if you can keep the same stable system running and replace your plugins, a new DKIM version, a new anti-spam, and into the mail system, and you're totally up to date. You don't have to do a forklift upgrade. Now, when to stop? That was in 2006 for a while, because after 3 years, you really have to start adding things to the system, or else it becomes abandonware, and that's not good. Okay, so POSIX has matured relatively well, implemented many small programs, which means I can add another small program or I can replace a small program. I don't really have to take the big crowbar tool and start ripping things apart. Extensibility is a lifesaver for everyone. It eliminates the pressure to implement everything and the kitchen sink within the mail system itself. I hope that with connection filtering, I can keep mail systems operable under increasing pressures of zombies, because Storm was just, you know, a sign on the wall. This is going to happen again. The peak handling overload will take care of many things, but if things really get bad, then you will need some system that sits in front of the mail system that just weeds out 90-95% of all the connections. And I think that's it. Yep. There's very little time for very few questions, but I already answered a few in the middle of the presentation, so just one or two questions. This is your time. Yes?
Whatever efforts did you make to find the sweet spot with your stress testing settings? Like, why is it 1 second or 5 seconds or 10 seconds? Did you do any research into finding the sweet spot?
No, desperate situations require desperate measures, you know. I've been using the 10 seconds for several years, under conditions of overload, and it's okay. But it's you only do this when the system is really hosed. People have told that 60 seconds is gives rarely problems, rarely. And the reason I know that 60 seconds can be too short is there was old SMTP clients will do a DNS lookup for the sender domain and for the recipient domain, because the old RFC says you cannot use aliases in SMTP commands. So if I do mail from foo at example.com, I do a DNS lookup to see if example.com is an alias. And then I do the same thing for recipient and recipient and recipient. And if your DNS is kind of screwed up, then it times out, I don't know how many times. And some resolved implementation had really bizarre, like 80 seconds. It could take 80 seconds before the DNS library would give up. And so if your server-side timeout is less than 80 seconds, then these guys will never get through. And normally they won't know, because their mail is just, you know, it's going out. It's just, well, 80 seconds delay in email is not really that noticeable, because email is not a real-time protocol. If it's a web server, then of course, well, things are different. Okay? Yeah, so 10 seconds is good for desperate measures. 20 seconds would be good for almost anywhere. Yeah? Oh yes, that's what I did. I collected the logs, then I smashed them up into the first three octets, and then I ran it through my database of geolocation information, and that's how I got the numbers of countries. Yes, the IP address. There's all kinds of information that I still have to mine out and won't have time to do, but I think I've kind of knacked the problem here. And if it's really necessary to implement more of the protocol to find out if something is a bot or not, then that's not a big deal, because I already have these in my stress testing tools. There are implementations of SMTP where I can make, well, thousands of parallel SMTP connections and just handle them. I can do the same thing for the protocol all the way. Okay? Well, last question.
If in your picture of the filtering, if a filter fails, is the mail then lost, or is it the same behavior like the Milter interface?
No.
No,
it's... like here, mm-hmm. It is not a proxy, so it accepts a connection, it looks in a whitelist database, and if the whitelist database says, I already checked this guy, then it gives the connection to postfix, and it is no longer involved. So if the process crashes, the only connections that you lose are the ones where it has not yet done the whitelist check, or where it is doing these horrible things that take 5-10 seconds that you don't want to do in your real SMTP server. So those you would lose.
That's the same with the Milter interface?
No, the Milter interface, if the Milter crashes, your session will not, well, depending on you can configure postfix that it will ignore the error.
Okay.
As in, okay, whatever. In this case, this is really really preliminary software, so it's all going to be rewritten, and the end result will look probably different. But if it crashes, it only handles a very limited number of connections, mostly bad guys, and a few good guys who are in transit from here to there, so those would be lost. But it's not the end of the world. They will just see that their connection doesn't happen, and they will connect again. Okay? Thank you.